Welcome to the first of three tutorials where we'll be looking at creating various isometric mapping aesthetics using the Digimap service from EDINA. We'll be using the Digimap data roam service and using this particular grid reference, which is an area just outside of Edinburgh for this example. Now, what you're going to need to download is the topography layer, the building height data, along with the OS Terrain 5 contours and OS Terrain 5 DTM, and then finally the vector map local. If you add those to the basket, and then when you view the basket, we need to set the format to DWG for all bar the OS Terrain 5 DTM, which is going to be an XYZ format. Now, once you've set that up, if you go to request download and it will email you and you will set up and download accordingly. So now that's done, if we look at importing the contour data, so if you go to your downloaded file, Terrain 5 NT and the Terrain 5 DWG, we're importing the file. We do not need to import anything that's unreferenced, so uncheck those. The rest of it's fine, and click OK. Now you'll notice I use Zoom Extents All or Zulu Echo Alpha because when you import from an Ordnance Survey DWG, it's using the Ordnance Survey grid format, and more likely than not, you are not going to be over the Rhino origin. So once that's all said and done, I'm going to be putting in some overarching layers to act as folders for this particular tutorial, and it's going to reduce your own headache and declutter your Rhino file. So we're going to have a boundary layer, a contours layer, point cloud terrain layer, the vector map local layer, and the building height layer. This is the same Rhino file I'll be using for all three tutorials, which is why we're setting it up as is right now. So once that's done, drag those contour layers into the contours folder. I'm also going to transfer all points and text data into a separate subfolder, but first I'm using cell block instance to get rid of unnecessary blocks that have been imported in. And as I said, now I'm creating a new layer, text layer, and I'm just going to drag and drop all of the text and point layers and label layers that we will not be needing. You could also delete them, but I'm just keeping them just for now, for safekeeping. All right, now that's done, the next thing we'll be doing is importing the vector map local. So go into the VML subfolder, NT, and VML DWG. Same again, import, same preferences, and that's going to import into the same grid point. There you go. Okay, so same again, drag and drop those into the overarching folder. And also, I'm going to do cell block instance again, delete the unnecessary blocks, and then put all point and text files, or layers, which we won't be needing immediately, into a subfolder called text, and hiding that. Once I'm done with that, next thing we're going to do is create a rectangular boundary. That's going to be coloured red, so if you go into the property for the boundary layer and click on the swatch, turn it to red, there you go. Now, type in the rectangle command. Top right hand corner of the blue water layer is where we're going to start. So if you have OSnap and end, then I'm going to use the 3-point subcommand, so type in P and enter, and then type in the length, which is going to be 5,000, because these tiles are 5 kilometer by 5 kilometer at 1 to 1,000. Enter, once you're happy, use the shift to help with orthogonal, and then enter again, and there you go. This is going to be our bounding rectangle for this example, and likely the subsequent examples. Disable vector map local, you no longer need it for this tutorial. I'm going to throw it out into perspective view for the rest of this tutorial. If I set it to isometric and northeast and then save the view, because this is what we're going to be exporting the view as when we get to Illustrator later on. Okay. Now, we're going to need to tidy up with these contour lines. I'm going to do that by joining them up, and to do that, we're going to need to duplicate the bounding box. You can see the contours are already arrayed along the z-axis as is appropriate, so we do not need to worry about that. This is why we use the terrain data rather than the vector map data for contours, because terrain data is arrayed. So I'm just copying the rectangles onto the same z-plane as the two water layers. I'm using copy vertical to do so, and I'm changing them onto the contour layer. And so there we go, copy vertical, so that's copy and then V and enter. All right, now I'm going to array linear. I'm just going to eyeball the number, there's 20. We're going to start off from the origin at a distance of 5, because that is what the regular contour line is spaced at, 5 meters. Once that's done, we can see that we've got a healthy number of rectangles, but we still need an additional 3. So to that end, I'm just going to copy the top 3 rectangles using copy vertical again. Select copy vertical, that's a V, mind my own typo, there we go. Set the point, and up we go. All right, so this is our basis. So next up, we're going to use the split command. We're going to select those rectangles we've just created. And then we're going to use the split command after we've selected the contours. So there we go, split. Select contours using Control A, enter, and your boundaries have now been split. First up, we're going to join the boundaries for the two water layers. So select the lower water layer and the outer boundary and join. I'm using Quick Menu, which is middle mouse button by default, and then do the same for the high watermark layer again and join. Okay, now we can hide those two water layers and come back to them later. I'm going to lock those two, that small collection of island contours there, so I don't accidentally select them. Now I'm going to select the remaining rectangles from the water's edge and delete, because we do not need those. Now you need to eyeball it. So this is the fastest way I have thus far discovered for closing a selection of contours, especially when I'm doing this isometric cube method. And that is just going around the edge and joining each one, not necessarily one at a time. Once you get the rhythm of the topography, you'll be able to join multiple ones at once without worrying about whether or not you're about to misstep. I'm going to speed up the footage here because you do not need to watch me join each and every single one. So, just a quick bit of background to this aesthetic. Whilst I think on it, I'm kind of looking back, I'm pretty certain some of the inspiration for this aesthetic actually came from an ancient computer game by today's standards called SimCity 4. Its map view was arranged in various different cube and cuboids, and you would end up with all of these beautiful isometric trunks because it was a game that was rendered in 2.5D rather than full 3D. But that's going back a bit. I also just enjoyed this particular aesthetic for me. And if it works for you, that's great, but I would strongly encourage you to iterate upon it, improve it, evolve it, rather than just copying what I've done by rote. Now we're done, I'm going to disable those contour layers and re-enable the water layers so we can tidy those up. You can see that we're going to need to close these curves because they are open curves, but drag it. So first things first, I'm going to go to Curve Tools, toolbar at the top, and go to Edge Analysis. Now I'm going to deselect everything but open curve starts. Now you can see that's highlighted and I know where this particular curve is open and needs to be joined. There we go. Delete the spare parts. Now that's done, I'm going to copy vertically the high water mark line onto the low water mark line plane. So I can use this as a template from which to trim. So if we select the low water mark, and then I just trim. So type in trim, and there we go. And just trim to your heart's content. All right, now that's done. I'm just gonna zoom in here. You can see you've got a bit of straggly here. I'm gonna use close curve here. I'm gonna delete those because you're never gonna see those. Then I'm going to select everything else and join. There we go. Now I'm going to use cell open curve again. Yep, no more open curves, that's great. Then show, then cell open curve. Yep, no more open curves, brilliant. So we can re-enable the main contour layers. Now I'm going to do some tidying of the layers. I'm going to change the master contour to ordinary because we don't need the separation. I'm going to change the colors of these layers to something more appropriate. And then I'm going to select all of these curves and go into properties, which is the circular tab underneath layers, the top here. And there we go, select all, and then display color by layer. There we go, now they're behaving themselves. All right, that's the tedious bit done. Next up, we need to create a base for this. So I'm going to create a new sublayer called base. And once again, I'm going to make a copy of the boundary box and copy it onto the base layer. You can see there I'm just using the right-click menu to select objects and copy onto layer rather than anything else. Now I'm going to shift this particular box down by -5 along the Z-axis using the same copy vertical command we've used previously. I'm also going to create a duplicate of this and shift it down another 20. You do not have to. I'm just doing this for my own sake. To give a quick eyeball. We're going to be extruding the top base curve in a moment. So yeah, you can see I'm copying this again vertically. -20. This is purely eyeballing. Then I'm going to extrude the top one down again. Snap yet the one I've created. I'm deleting the bottom one now. Now we can see, I think that's a bit too thin as a base layer. So this is a good opportunity to use the scale 1D command. So we zoom back into that corner, type in scale 1D. So this will just scale on this one particular axis. Select start point. I'm just gonna eyeball it again and say 50. So I'm gonna type in 50. Okay, that's done. Now, to speed up the next section, when we export into Illustrator, we're going to go into Grasshopper. Now, you can see I've already pre-prepared a script. I'm going to walk you through how I generated this. First things first, you're going to need an extension called Elefront. I'm using version 4.3 at the moment. This is their legacy version for Rhino 6, but it works perfectly well in Rhino 7. Now, make sure you've saved your work before you install the Elefront script and then restart Rhino and Grasshopper. Once that is done, you'll be able to continue with this particular tutorial and we'll be setting up the script next. Now, I'm going to start from scratch again so you know what I'm doing. First things first, double click on the panel and type in curve, and that brings you a curve segment. Now we're going to need to get the planar analysis element. I just go down to the curve menu, which is the fifth one along, down to the analysis, and then we are looking for planar, S curve for planarity. All right, next component, point deconstruct. So just type in deconstruct. After that, we want CSET, which is create set, as well as sort. Sort list is what we're looking for. We're going to need two components of those, so just copy and paste. List item is the next one, followed by M index, which is member index. That's part of the set panel as well. And then again, a list item, so I'll just copy and paste that one, followed by another curve, followed by Boolean toggle. Now, this is the one component we're using from Elephant, and that's create hatch. Okay, the purpose, and one last one we'll need is a number slider, but I'll generate that in a moment once you understand where I've got the numbers from. Now, the reason for this particular setup is what we're going to be doing in Illustrator is fundamentally creating solid fills. What you can do in Rhino is create hatches which then export as solid fills into Illustrator. And the great thing about this is if you have incredibly complex contours, this particular script is going to sort them by z-axis value. And so they're going to keep the contours planar and they're going to hatch them accordingly. And now we're going to join all of these elements up. So where do we get these indices from? I'll show you. So if we pop back into Rhino for a second, I'm just going to hide the base, mean low water, and mean high water lines, because our main focus is on this series of contours. We can generate the hatches for the high and low water line manually, and I'll do that in a moment. With the contour curve selected in Rhino, if we head back into Grasshopper and right-click on the first curve container and click on Select Multiple Curves, it is from these curves that the indices in question will be generated from. I'm just going to quickly hide all the previews we do not need right now to reduce clutter. And you can also see that we have 23 sorted keys that we will need to run through. So double click and we're going to create a number slider. So type in 0 followed by the less than symbol and 22 and enter. And we're going to plug that into list item. Now we're going to be able to scroll through that list to automatically generate the required hatches for the contour using the create hatch element at the end of this particular script chain. Now if I switch this on, immediately we see the first hatch. And all I need to do is drag that over and automatically all the hatches we need have been generated. How's about that? Magic. Magic of Grasshopper. Now we can disable that again, fix the view, and I can minimize that. Now you'll see all of the hatches are black. Why? Because they've been generated under default. So we just select change object layer and they're on the right layer. Okay, we can switch off that layer now and jump into the next one and hatch. That way the hatch will go directly onto that layer and we're going to do the same thing for high water line. Alright, that's that. So that is all of that done. Next port of call, we do cell curve and lock. Okay. Now we're going to copy these, and for ease, I'm just going to copy from this point here and then V0.0. Now, if I go back to this preset view, this is, you can see here on the origin. Now I'm going to use scale command, click that, and then do by 1/10. The reason we're doing this is currently, or it was rather, at 1:1000, which still means the square was 5000 by 5000. And then we can export with origin 0.0.0.0. We do not need to export the viewport boundary. C scale is 1:1 because we've already scaled it in Rhino. Export hatches. Hatches exported to solid fills. Now that was the critical one I was speaking of earlier. This is why we went through that process in Grasshopper. And we do not need to worry about that warning because we are purposely exporting this in isometric view. All right, now that's done. If we throw in the cube, and we can see that it's fitting relatively nicely on an A2. I'm just going to recenter this A2 artboard. There we go. And I'm just going to then drag this down so it's sitting nice and pretty like. That'll do. Now, we still need to fit this on the board, so I'm just going to decrease it by 50%. Yep, that'll do. I'm going to recenter you. There we go. Okay. So you can see that we basically have our hatches pre-prepared. Now, I'm going to plop in one more layer, which we'll be using later, called embellish, and that will be for various little embellishments, atmospherics I'll be showing you later. First things first though, we need to convert the base into a solid. To do that, easiest way is Life Paint Tool, shortcut is just K, and then I'm going to switch it so it's a fill using Shift X. And then just fill this up. There we go. Next thing we're going to do, once that's select all and remove the stroke, because we do not need the stroke. Now we go into Object, Life Paint, Expand. I'm going to do Control Shift G to remove it from the group, because we need to do it into two separate groups. Base Top, which will now hide, and Base Edge. And there we go. I'm going to set the base top to 75% opacity. And then we're going to lock the base. Now, that's already a solid fill for us. So I'm just going to set that to 66% opacity. And I'm going to change the color of the top layer now to pure cyan so it matches the lower, setting it to 66% opacity as well. And you can see now with the hatches, all of these small details and infills, they've come through nice and clean. And now, going to do the same thing with this one. However, we're going to need to use Control A to do so when we're setting the opacity. Because if I set it from the overarching layer, that's just going to set it from the layer's point of view rather than these individual objects' point of view. So either use Control A or drag a box. Now, I'm going to set the contours to pure white and lower the opacity to 25%. And you can see that's actually quite a stark contrast. If I lower it to 20%, it's a bit more muted. For me, it's about 50-50 between both. I'll leave it as such for now. Now, the other thing we can do is if we copy and paste or duplicate this contour layer, then lock, what we can do is bring back the outlines. So I'm going to throw that back to opacity of 100. I'm going to switch you around using Shift X, and then I'm going to switch you to black and set the contour to 0.25. And you can see we've got some nice little outline going on here. Now, I'm actually going to decrease the opacity to 50% here, because I feel that provides a nice hint without it being overwhelming. Now that's done. We can lock these, and we can save this, and then next thing I'm going to do is pull a, here's one I did earlier. So, these clouds and trees I created during fourth year of my master's. To do this, what I did was I used the vector art brush tool. So if you just go into brushes, and then you can see all of these watercolor and charcoal ones I've used. And if you want to open them up yourself, you just go down to the library and then you go to is it artistic and then calligraphic, charcoal, pencil, ink, paintbrush, scrubbing, watercolor. I used all of those particular brushes to get these kind of clouded effects, and I changed the stroke width, the opacity of all of these particular brushes, and I added drop shadow, which you go down to FX and then stylize and drop shadow. It's in the first segment to stylize and drop shadow. And then if I just select one of these and drop shadow, and you can see. And you can see I've also used the feather command as well for this particular one. So. Now, I'm just going to copy these into the previous document. So we've got plenty of material to play with. And here we go. I'm not going to be using all of these, but I'm going to play with a few so you get the idea. Et voila. So now we're going to save and export as a PNG. Export as, and then contour cube. Use artboards, make sure that is checked. Saves your hassle later. Saving it as 300 ppi with a transparent background, and OK. And we're done. We've covered a lot of ground in this tutorial, Rhino, Grasshopper, and Illustrator, and bits in between. We'll be continuing from about where we left off in the next tutorial. In the meantime, thank you, and if you have questions or comments, please put them below.